Hello friends, welcome to the amendment lecture on GST for CA final as applicable for November 2019 examination. Friends, these amendments will include amendments as made to the Act via GST Amendment Act 2018, amendment to the rules, amendment which are brought out through notification, circulars and orders. These are all going to be based upon the statutory update which is released by ICAI on GST. Friends, I doubt there would be any other attempt where you can find so many amendments, at least as which are brought through the GST Amendment Act 2018. Friends, since GST was introduced from 1st of July 2017, it was introduced through GST, CGST Act 2017 as applicable for our examination. It is CGST Act 2017 and IGST Act 2017. Now friends, these laws which were being introduced were introduced for the first time in the nation. So based on the experience, based on the feedback of the industry, there are very many changes which have been brought through the Act itself, through the CGST Amendment Act 2018 and IGST Amendment Act 2018. So I doubt there could be any other attempt other than this November 2019 attempt where there was a fresh overlook of the Act itself. So many changes which are there in the Act. And this is a very good news because at least as far as my calculation goes, you can expect around 20 to 25 marks from amendment this time because there are so many amendments. Wherever you look into, you will find only amendments and amendments. So therefore, please concentrate on this lecture. Once you concentrate and complete this lecture with confidence, you can be sure of at least 20 to 25 marks out of the 75 marks of the GST. Now friends, good things first. The exclusions, which is given by the study guidelines of ICAI as applicable for November 2019 examination. Let's see what is excluded from your syllabus. Rate of tax prescribed for supply of goods is not required. Rate of tax prescribed for supply of services is not required. So you need not remember the rate of tax for goods and services. However, you have to remember the rate of tax as applicable for a composition taxable person who pays taxes under Section 10. Exemption for supply of goods is not required. However, exemption for supply of services is very much a part of your syllabus. Categories of supply of goods, taxes on which is payable under reverse charge mechanism, is not a part of your syllabus. However, categories of supply of services upon which tax needs to be paid under RCM is very much a part of your syllabus. Manner of determination and reversal of input tax credit, as regards as the real estate project is concerned, it is not applicable for your syllabus. Friends, please understand, it is only manner and determination of input tax credit which is not applicable. You have certain other areas as regards as the real estate sector is concerned which is applicable. Reverse charge mechanism under 9 subsection 3, reverse charge mechanism under 9 subsection 4, certain exemption in the real estate sector, all these things coupled with special provisions for time of supply for real estate sector are still applicable. These are all the changes which have been brought for the first time. As regards as return filing is concerned, since portal is not cooperating with the law initially was structured and portal did not follow the law. So therefore, these return filing GSTR 2, GSTR 1A, GSTR 3, 7 and 8 is not applicable. Claim of input tax credit and provisional acceptance thereof is not being followed practically, so therefore not applicable for examination as well. Matching reversal and reclaim of ITC, matching reversal and reclaim of reduction of output tax liability is not applicable. All these are not applicable because it is not happening in real life. Transitional provisions, which do not have any much relevance as of now, so these are not applicable for examination. Now friends, before starting, let us have a few guidelines as to how to deal with these lectures. For LearnCab students, so for the students who are subscribed to LearnCab and watching the GST lectures, the lectures which they are watching or which they have already watched for November 2019 as applicable for November 2019 are already updated. They are all updated except for one small change in composition scheme. Rather, it is not a change. There are two views. Institute has got one view, whereas there are other view also which exists. We'll just update ourselves as to what is the view of the institute. Other than this change, which we are just immediately going to start with, other than that, all the lectures are fully updated for November 2019. However, for those students of LearnCab who have already prepared for for May 2019 attempt and are reappearing in November 2019 attempt, or for those students who are actually appearing in November 2019 but have already watched the lectures of May 2019, they could watch this lecture and then update themselves as to the provisions as applicable for November 2019. I repeat, for those students who are directly watching November 2019 attempt, for them the lectures are fully updated, excepting the composition scheme slight change in view, which we are going to discuss. ABC analysis and the amendment notes are attached. You can download them and study through them. The general presumption through which these lectures are going to proceed is, discussion is going to happen only on the change portion. Discussion is going to happen only on the amended portion. The basic provisions you are expected to know. We are not going to discuss the basic provisions. Unless and until you know the basic provisions, you will not be able to appreciate the change. However, what was before, what is the requirement for change, and what has changed, we will be discussing at the relevant areas. Still, it is expected that you know the base, because without the base, you will not be able to appreciate the changed portion. So please do not look directly into this amendment lecture. First go through your basics, brush them up, and only then come and watch this amendment lecture. Otherwise, it is going to be a mere waste of time. So we are going to discuss only the change portion. You are expected to know the basics. Now friends, students who have been asking for the books, the book is available at this website. You can place your order if you require. So for CA final, there are two modules, module 1 and module 2. Module 1 is multicolored. There are around 300 plus concept examples in module 1 and 200 plus concept examples in module 2. So totaling to 500 plus concept examples. This book has been co-authored by me along with my partner CA Vishal Jain. As regards as CA IPCC is concerned, for CA IPCC, there is only one module. You've got 300 plus concept examples. So you can, if at all you require, you can order this book through the website which is given over here. The link is also provided in the description. Time of supply for composition scheme. Friends, as regards as section 12 is concerned, any person who is supplying goods, for him, for determining the time of supply, the date on which he is actually receiving the payment is not relevant. However, it is going to be relevant for those persons who are opting to pay taxes under section 10. So the provision tells you, according to section 12, time of supply for goods under forward charge mechanism, the date on which you have received the payment is not relevant, because time of supply tells you the due date of the actual date of issuance of invoice or the last date on which you are supposed to issue an invoice. However, for composition taxable person, according to the section, the date on which you receive the payment, even for supply of goods, is relevant. Now, friends, ICAI has taken a stand. The view of ICAI tells you that even for composition scheme, even for a person who is paying taxes under composition scheme, the date on which he is receiving the payment is not relevant. The date on which he is receiving the payment is not relevant because a person who is paying taxes under section 10 is paying taxes as a percentage of his turnover. As a percentage on his turnover, and the amount which he has received as advance does not form a part of the turnover. The amount which he has received as advance doesn't form a part of a turnover. So therefore, even for a composition taxable person who is supplying goods, the date on which he is receiving advance, the date on which he is receiving the payment is not relevant, is the stand taken by ICAI. Now friends, as far as your examination is concerned, of course, you have to go with this view. You have to go with the view that even for a composition taxable person who is supplying goods, the date on which he is receiving payment or the date on which he is receiving any advance is not relevant. Even for him, the time of supply is not going to be based upon the date on which he received the advance, because he is going to pay tax as a percentage of the turnover. Now friends, this is as regards as your examination is concerned. However, I'll also tell you what is the other view which exists. The other view which exists is, agreed that composition taxable person is paying taxes as a percentage of his turnover. But how do you determine this turnover? How do you determine this turnover? Is this turnover the turnover according to the general accounting parlance which is being understood, or is this a turnover which needs to be found out, which needs to be calculated based on the provisions of GST law, based on time of supply, based on value of supply, are you supposed to find out this turnover and then pay a tax as a percentage of the turnover calculated according to the GST law. So the second view told that even though advance doesn't form a part of the turnover as understood in the general accounting parlance, but this turnover is not the general accounting turnover, it is the turnover determined according to the provisions of GST law, taking into consideration time of supply provisions, taking into consideration value of supply provisions. Say for example, if a composition taxable person is selling a fixed asset, let's suppose a composition taxable person sells his computer or he's selling his furniture, which is his fixed assets. Now, according to the general accounting parlance, does this form a part of his turnover? The answer is no. So, does it mean a composition taxable person, when he's selling his fixed assets, need not pay tax at all because he's paying taxes as a percentage of a turnover and this is not included in the turnover? The answer is no. Even on sale of his fixed assets, he still has to pay the rate of tax. If he's a manufacturer, 1%, trader also 1%, if he's a restaurant service provider, he needs to pay tax at the rate of 5%. So friends, the point which we are trying to analyze is, here, even though they tell that it is a percentage of turnover, it is not the turnover as understood in the accounting parlance, it is the turnover as determined by applying the provisions of time of supply, the provisions of value of supply of GST law. And when you find out the turnover according to the time of supply of provisions, when you find out the turnover according to the time of supply provisions of the GST law, then receipt of advance by a composition taxable person for supply of goods also becomes relevant. So this is the other view which exists. However, I would like to give you the concluding remarks. We have to go with the ICAI view, wherein we conclude stating that as regards as a composition taxable person is concerned, since he is paying taxes as a percentage of his turnover, for him, receipt of advance is not at all a criteria. The date on which he is receiving the money is not at all a criteria, is the stand which we are going to take for this coming attempt. Let's have a look at the amendment which is there in the definition. Section 2 clause 102 defines services. So basically tells you, services means anything other than goods. It excludes money and securities. But however, as regards as money is concerned, activities relating to money is been covered in the definition in the includes portion. Let's have a look at it. So services means anything other than goods. It excludes money and securities. But however, activities which are relating to money, two things are excluded, money as well as securities. Activities which are relating to the usage of money is there in the includes portion of the service definition, which tells you activities relating to the use of money for which a separate consideration is being charged. Let's read them separately. So activities relating to point number one, use of money for which a separate consideration is being charged. That means, let's suppose I give you a loan of 10 lakh rupees and I'm charging interest for it. Now the activity of me giving a loan to you, it is a supply of service for which consideration is in the form of interest. Point number two, activities relating to its conversion from one form of currency to another form of currency. In this case, wherever currency is being exchanged and for which a consideration is being charged, that happens to be a supply of service. Now friends, this definition, prior to the amendment, it was only so much. They have included an explanation to this definition. The explanation reads, for the removal of doubts, it is hereby clarified that the expression services includes facilitating or arranging the transactions in securities. Now friends, have a comparative look. What was outside the definition of services was money and securities. However, activities relating to the usage of money was again inside the definition of service. But the section was silent about the activities which are related to securities. Say for example, you're buying and selling securities for which your broker is charging a commission. Now, the activity of buying and selling of securities is per se not services. However, the activities which are related to, that means for facilitating or arranging the purchase or sale of securities, that happens to be a supply of service, like how it was in the case of money. It happens to be a supply of service in case of securities as well. So they have included an explanation which reads as under, for the removal of doubts, it is hereby clarified that the expression services will include facilitating or arranging the transactions in securities. So in our example, that commission which is being charged, that is going to be a supply of consideration for the supply of service which was in the nature of facilitating or arranging the transaction securities. Now friends, is this anything new which is being told over here? The answer is no. The understanding from the very beginning was as such. It is only clarificatory in nature. The position of law, even if this amendment was not there, was the same thing. It is only a clarificatory nature which can be found out from the wordings which have been employed in the explanation. It is actually an explanation which is added to section 2 clause 102. The explanation starts with the wordings for the removal of doubts. That means if at all you have any doubts, please remove it. But the position of law, we are just clarifying it now. From earlier also the position remained the same and it is fair enough. Next, section 2 clause 17, the definition of business. So amongst you have point number H, which tells you, which told you rather, prior to amendment, the wordings were like this. Services provided by a race club by way of totalizer or license to a bookmaker in such club. Now this was included in the definition of business. Now there was some problem because of the wordings which are employed in this particular provision. This particular provision used the wordings services provided by a race club. Now friends, basically a race club is into betting. It is making a supply of bets. Now friends, as regards as betting is concerned, betting happens to be an actionable claim. Betting happens to be an actionable claim. You can take reference from Schedule 3 if you remember. Schedule 3, there was a provision, there was a paragraph which told you actionable claims other than lottery, betting and gambling are neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services. That means betting happens to be an actionable claim. So friends, betting is an actionable claim, and if you could recall the definition of goods, the definition of goods includes actionable claim. So actionable claim per se happens to be goods. But now the wordings which are employed by this provision, it tells you services provided by a race club. So there was some confusion that when betting amounts to goods, why is the language which is used over here is services. There's no doubt this race club, it supplies goods as well as services. Race club not alone supplies goods, it supplies services as well. It provides the license to a bookmaker. So now the scope was narrowed down when the wordings which were used for services, because this race club supplies goods as well as services. Actionable claim is goods, it supplies bets. License to bookmaker is services, it makes a supply of service as well. So therefore, to remove the confusions, they widened the scope. Rather than services, they used the words activities. So which means it will cover goods as well as services. So activities of a race club including by way of a totalizer, a license to a bookmaker, or activities of a licensed bookmaker in such club. Now friends, what does a race club do? A race club, it directly takes betting. Directly taking betting by a race club, there's an automated system called as totalization. So through an automated system of totalizer, this betting is directly being taken by the race club. Alternatively, this race club also gives a license to a bookmaker, and this bookmaker will in turn take the bets. So now friends, what is this point number H covering? It tells you all these activities. Which activities? The activities of a race club including by way of a totalizer. That means the race club directly taking bets. It is a supply of goods. It is actionable claim which happens to be a supply of goods. Next one, the license to a bookmaker, or race club is not taking the bets directly, it is taking through a bookmaker for this bookmaker to be authorized to take the bets in this particular race club. He needs to obtain a license. This license is actually a supply of service, which is also covered into business. It says the words activities. The next one, the activities of a licensed bookmaker in such club. Now this bookmaker in turn is going to take the bets from public. So now this activity, this bookmaker is undertaking a supply of goods. This also happens to be business. So friends, essentially the bottom line is only so much. There was confusion because of the wordings which were used for services. They replaced the services by the wordings employed as activities. The next change, charging section, section 9. Now friends, as regards as section 9 is concerned, you have section 9 subsection 3, 9 subsection 4 and 9 subsection 5. There are essentially 5 subsections, rather 9 subsection 1, 9 subsection 2, 9.3, 9.4, 9.5. 9.1 is the basic charging section. 9.2 tells you petroleum products will be inside GST from a notified date. 9.3 and 9.4 reverse charge mechanism. 9.5 where an electronic commerce operator is made liable to pay the taxes. There's a change in 9 subsection 4. There's a change in 9 subsection 4. First, let us understand what the erstwhile 9 subsection 4 told you. 9 subsection 3 and 9 subsection 4 is about reverse charge. The erstwhile 9 subsection 4 told you, if the supplier happens to be an unregistered person, supply could be of either goods or services, and if the recipient happens to be a registered person. So if the supplier is an unregistered person who's supplying any goods or any services to a registered recipient, to a recipient who happens to be a registered person, then the liability to pay tax on the supply of such goods and services shall be on recipient, and it was called as reverse charge mechanism. Now what does the amended 9 subsection 4 tell you? The amended 9 subsection 4 tells you, the government may, on the recommendations of the council by notification, specify a class of registered persons. Please understand, it tells you a class of registered persons who shall, in respect of supply of specified categories of goods or services or both, received from an unregistered supplier. Then the liability to pay taxes shall be on the recipient. So friends, now they have narrowed down the scope of 9 subsection 4. Earlier friends, 9 subsection 4's scope was very wide. Let's suppose there was a tea vendor. You're a chartered accountant, a practicing CA, a person who's supplying tea comes to your office and supplies tea. Now, if he happens to be unregistered, and of course it is a supply of service, and you happen to be a registered person, you are liable to pay GST under reverse charge mechanism. Of course, there was an exemption of 5,000 rupees per day, and then they lifted that exemption also. But now they have statutorily, no requirement of exemption, they have statutorily trimmed down the scope of 9 subsection 4. So 9 subsection 4, now it reads a class of registered persons. So earlier it told you only registered person. Now it tells you notified registered persons. So not all registered persons will be hit by 9 subsection 4. It is only notified registered persons who will be hit by 9 subsection 4. Next, in respect of supply of specified categories of goods or services or both. So friends, earlier it was any goods or any services, if it was supplied by an unregistered person, 9 subsection 4 took a hit. Now it tells you it is only supply of notified goods and services received from an unregistered supplier. This stands the same, unregistered supplier. So friends, any unregistered person supplying notified goods and services to a notified registered recipient, then this notified registered recipient needs to pay GST under reverse charge mechanism. Now friends, they have notified one activity which is in relation to the real estate sector. You will be seeing that after a few minutes. There's a separate segment for real estate where we'll be covering all the related topics. So now friends, as of now, just understand, so far there's only one notification which has come. Only one class of registered persons has been specified who will be hit by the provisions of 9 subsection 4. But basically, please understand 9 subsection 4, the scope is being trimmed down. Notified goods and services received by a registered recipient who is also notified, only then RCM under 9 subsection 4 gets attracted. So now friends, these are the cases where a person other than the supplier is supposed to pay the taxes. In 9 subsection 3, supplier could be any person, goods and services are notified, recipient could be any person, the liability to pay tax is upon the recipient, and it is called as reverse charge mechanism. 9 subsection 4, supplier is unregistered, goods and services are notified. Recipient is again a notified registered recipient. It is liable the recipient is liable to pay GST under reverse charge mechanism. 9 subsection 5, supplier could be any person. It is only services which can be notified, and the recipient can be any person. Such being the case, it is the electronic commerce operator who is supposed to pay GST, and this is not called as reverse charge mechanism, because under reverse charge mechanism, the liability is on the recipient of goods or services to pay the taxes. And over here, electronic commerce operator is not a recipient, so we do not call this as reverse charge mechanism. So friends, what we understand is only there is an amendment in 9 subsection 4. The scope has been narrowed down to a large extent.